नमस्कार, हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज देशु चीरा फ्रॉम हंसका एकेडमी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू लर्न अबाउट द एज ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन रिमेनिंग टॉपिक्स विच यू हैव डन इन द प्रीवियस वीडियो। फर्स्ट विल बी टेकिंग फैक्ट्रीज कमिंग अप इज अ सब टॉपिक। इन दैट विल बी डिस्कसिंग व्हाट आर द फर्स्ट फैक्ट्रीज दैट वेर एस्टैब्लिश्ड, who were the early entrepreneurs in India, where did the workers come from, where did the workers come from the different areas, then what are the peculiarities of the industrial growth, then we'll be looking at the small scale industries, how did they dominate the picture, and then we'll be learning what are the marketing strategies that are used for selling their goods. So let us get into the details now. Let me share my screen. Hello everyone. So here is a slideshow which is presented for you to make a notes. Factories coming up. This is a subtopic. In the age of industrialization, the first cotton mill in Bombay has come up in 1854, but it did not go for production immediately. It took nearly 2 years to start the production. So the first cotton mill was established in 1854, but it went into production only after 2 years. Similarly, in 1862, four mills were at work with 94,000 spindles, the wombs, and 2,150 looms. We have in 1862, four mills working with 94,000 spindles and 2,150 looms. Now, at the same time, it's around some 1850s to 1860s. The jute mills also have come up in Bengal. The first jute mill has come up in 1855, and the next one has come up 7 years after the first jute mill has come up, that is in 1862. The first mill has come up in 1855. The second one has come 7 years later, that is 1862. And coming to the northern part of India, so we saw Bombay, we saw Bengal region. Now moving to the North India, in Kanpur, the Elgin Mill was set up in 1860s. And a year later, the first cotton mill was set up in Ahmedabad. So that's how in North India, the factories have come up. Coming to the South, in Madras region, the first spinning mill was set up in 1874. So by 1880, almost in all corners of India, we have the establishment of factories. First, let us see in the western side, in Bombay in 1854, but it started its production in 1856. Moving to the eastern side, in Bengal region, in 1855, they have started the first one, jute mill. And in 1862, they started the second jute mill. Coming to northern part in Kanpur, in UP region, here in 1860, they have started. And a year later, it was started in Ahmedabad near Gujarat. Similarly, in south, complete down south, in 1874, the first spinning mill and weaving mill of Madras has begun its production. So here is a list of the factories which have come up, which is very useful for you people to write the one mark questions. Or in matching also, they can give, like giving you one side the years, the other side when the factories have come up. You can see in 1854, the first cotton mill has come up in Bombay. 1855, first jute mill in Bengal. 1862, four cotton mills have come up. 1862, one jute mill in the eastern side, Bengal region. 1860s, the Elgin Mill at Kanpur. 1861, first cotton mill at Ahmedabad, 1874, the first spinning and weaving mill of Madras began its production. So this is very, very important data. I request all of you to please make a note of the years and in which place, which factory has come up. 1862, you should remember that 4 cotton mills and 1 jute mill. So 1862 is a guarantee question, because there are 2 factors. Cotton mills are there, jute mill is established. 1874 is the last where it began in Madras. In Ahmedabad, 1861. So you should remember year wise. 54, 55, 60, 61, 62, then 74. So 54 is Bombay, 55 Bengal, 60s Kanpur, 61 Ahmedabad, 62 4 cotton mills and jute mill, and 74 at Madras. So like this, if you prepare a table, it is very easy for all of you to remember this particular years in a sequence. 54 B, 55 BE, then 60 K, 61 A, 62 4 C, 4 numeric C, comma 1 J, then 74 M. Like that, if you can remember, it will be very easy for you to remember. Now coming to the early entrepreneurs, many Indians have been playing an active role in the trade with the foreign countries, especially China. How they were playing the active role? They were providing finance, they were procuring the supplies and shipping the consignments. So Indians were playing an active role, not like main traders. They were playing the parts of it, means junior players. They are not doing completely the business. They were taking the subcontracts from the main companies, and they sometimes used to procure the supply, sometimes used to take the shipment consignment, sometimes they provide finance. Like that, the small junior players or the early entrepreneurs in India have earned money through this trade consignments. So initially, the Indian businessmen were not doing the complete trade operations. They were providing finance, procuring supplies, and also doing shipment consignments. Through this trade factor, they have earned some income. While they have earned some income, some of the businessmen planned that they want to develop their industrial enterprises in India. So they want to establish their industries in India. So one such was Dwarkanath Tagore, has made his fortune in China trade before he turned to industrial investments. So he did trade with China and he earned a lot of money. After earning some money, he want to start industrial investment in India. So he has set up 6 joint stock companies in the 1830s and 1840s. As I told you, there are many Indians who played the junior players in the trade. They used to do the consignment activities and they used to earn money. Few of them thought of investing in India and start their own enterprises. So one such was Dwarkanath Tagore. So he has earned money through trade consignments to China, and he has set up 6 joint stock companies between 1830 and 1840. Unfortunately, Tagore's enterprises sank along with those others in the wider crisis of 1840. So whatever investment Dwarkanath Tagore has kept has gone into zero. The companies have collapsed. In Bombay, Parsis like Dinshaw Pettit, Jamshedji, Nusranwanji Tata, who built huge industrial empires in India, also accumulated their wealth partly from exports to China. Dwarkanath's case was a failure because we don't know which business will be successful, which is not successful. So here he tried to invest in the stock companies and he has set up them, but he lost in 1840 crisis. But in Bombay, the Parsis like Dinshaw, Pettit and Jamshedji, Nazarenvanji, Tata has built huge industrial empires in India. You know, even now they are big shots. So they have also acquired their initial wealth from China. So they used to take the raw cotton shipments to England. That was the work they used to do during that period. So who are the other players? We have Seth Hukumchand, a Marwadi businessman who has set up the first Indian jute mill in Calcutta in 1970. He also acquired partly his investments from trading with China. Then the father as well as the grandfather of the famous industrialist, G.D. Birla, he also has started this business by trading. As the colonial control, as the British's control over the Indian trade got tightened, means they started to put strict rules, the space within which Indian merchants could function became increasingly limited because the scope became limited. They started to put more taxes on these people. So they were barred from trading with Europe in manufacturing goods. So they have put restrictions like, we cannot trade with the Europeans in manufacturing goods, and had to export mostly the raw material only. The raw material and food grains such as raw cotton, opium, wheat and indigo, as which is required by the British. So they kept conditions. You cannot supply the manufacturing goods. You can only supply for us the raw materials and the food grains. There were also gradually edged out of the shipping businesses. Slowly they want to push out all the Indian businessmen, Indian merchants from the shipping businesses. So we learned in this part, who are the early entrepreneurs here? So mainly Indians used to play a junior player's role by taking small consignments, providing finance, supplies, shipping the consignments, and they have made some fortune. So some of them want to invest in India and set up an industrial enterprise. Dwarkanath tried in 1830 to 1840 by setting up joint stock companies, but the companies have sank because of the wider business crisis in 1840. But it was not the case with others. In Bombay, we saw Parsis like Dinshaw and Tatas who have made huge industrial empires in India. They also have accumulated their wealth initially from China. Similarly, we have Marwadi businessmen, Seth Hukumchand, J.D. Birla's father and grandfather. These people earned their money through trade with foreign, especially China, but the Britishers have kept strict control over them. Slowly they want to edge them out. For that, they have barred them from trading with Europe in manufacturing goods. Similarly, they only gave condition that you can only export raw materials and the food grains to British, like raw cotton, opium, wheat, and indigo, which are required for them. That's why they allowed them. Otherwise, they would have not allowed to supply even that also. Because their target was to gradually edge them out of the shipping businesses. So where did the workers come from? This is the next subtopic. Where did the workers come from? In most industrial regions, as you can see here, workers came from the districts around the region. Suppose the industry is located here, from the surrounding districts, they have come here because in the villages, they could not find any work. So they approached to the nearest industrial center in search of some job, some work. So 50% of the workers in Bombay cotton industries in 1911 came from the neighboring districts of Ratnagiri, where the mills of Kanpur got most of the textiles from the villages within the districts of Kanpur. So the workers have come from the neighboring villages. Most often, mill workers moved between the village and the city. So returning to their village homes during the harvesting and the festival times. So in most of the industrial regions, the workers had come from the districts around the industrial center. Example, in Bombay, more than 50% of the workers came from the neighboring district of Ratnagiri. Same with the mills in Kanpur. They have come from the surrounding districts of Kanpur. Like that. So, over time, as the news of employment spread, workers started to travel to great distances in the hope of getting a work in the mill, especially from the United Provinces, the central region where Bombay is there. There, they went to work in the textile mills and also in jute mills in Calcutta. So getting a job is not so easy during those days. It was a very tough job. The number of job seekers were always more than the number of jobs available. What is the problem or what is the concern is, suppose there are 10 jobs, the number of people requesting for jobs would be 20 or 30 people. That's why entry into the mills was also restricted. Industrialists usually employed a jobber. What is the role of a jobber? This is a 3 marks question. Please make a note of it. Industrialists always employed a person called jobber, whose duty is to recruit the new people, the new jobs. He got people from his village and ensured them they get a job. And he also helped them to settle in the city and provide them money in times of crisis. So the company used to appoint a senior most employee as a jobber. He uses his contacts and calls people from villages. So when you are coming from a village to a town, you don't have your own houses here. So the jobber also takes care of the finding of the houses, giving some money in advance for them, for paying the rents, for staying in the place, and then he used to take care of them at the time of crisis. That is the role of the jobber.